There's something about the Man of Steel. Superman has endured for 75 years, captivating people of all ages. From scrappy crime fighter to American icon, the character reflects the changing world around him. But Superman always stays true to one ideal, helping others. The hero's evolution is the subject of a new book, Superman, the Unauthorized Biography by Glen Weldon. He covers pop culture and comics for NPR and joins me now. So I'd like to start with the big picture. Mm-hmm. Why do superheroes and comic book characters resonate with America? And how do they evolve along with our society?
Sure. Well, these characters, it might sound corny to say these characters are our modern myths, but it's true. They exist on a symbolic level. And there's no more symbolic character than Superman, who created the archetype of the superhero. And everything that has come after him that's touched on the idea of somebody who dresses up in a weird outfit and fights for the powers of good comes from him.
And so, turning directly to Superman, in your book, you chronicle his journey from his comic book debut, April 18th, 1938, to the silver screen and call him the most recognizable figure of the superhero genre. Why is it? Is it just longevity?
No, actually, because he created the archetype, and that's also because, you know, his costume is primary colors, red, yellow, and blue, and he was the one who... Everybody who came after him was imitating or reacting to. But he does evolve. That's the thing about these characters. When I was researching the book, I wanted to show both what has stayed essentially the same about this character over 75 years and what's changed. And specifically, what do those things that have changed about him say about us? And what is the fact that a certain part of him has stayed completely the same for 75 years say about us as well? And basically, the only thing about him that hasn't changed at all in 75 years is his motivation. At first glance, it's a pretty basic hero motivation. He puts the needs of others over those of himself, and he never gives up. And when both of those things are present, you have a Superman story. When one or more of those things is missing, it just doesn't feel like Superman, because that's who this character is.
And so the motivations for his good deeds. You wrote that he was once decidedly anti-militaristic, far removed from the uber-patriot he would become. So how did that happen? How did truth, justice, and the American way really become his motto?
Well, when he was created by both Siegel and Shuster, they wanted him to be a sort of a progressive character. And he starts off going after people we would now consider the 1%. Who does he go after? He goes after corporate fat cats. It goes after crooked politicians. It goes after manufacturers who created shoddy goods that were unsafe for the public.
Coal miners that had unsafe practices.
Absolutely. Right? So he was going after and trying to upset the status quo, and he was kind of doing it in kind of very rough way. He was not the paragon of virtue we see today. He was kind of a tough guy. But World War II came along and softened all of those hard edges. And all of a sudden he went from attacking the status quo to vigorously defending it. Mm-hmm. So when World War II began, he was basically a children's comic book character. But because of the patriotic imagery and his use as a patriotic symbol throughout the war, by the end of the war, he was an American icon.
And so specifically on that World War II shift, you saw him used in war propaganda from the United States government.
He was helping to sell war bonds and telling people to plant victory gardens, absolutely. And he was doing that on the cover of his books, not necessarily in the adventures, because the editors and writers were very cognizant that if you show Superman going over to Europe and bashing some Nazis around, you would be trivializing the sacrifices of the American GI. So they wrote a story in the comic strip where Clark Kent goes to enlist, but he gets so excited that he accidentally reads the eye chart in the next room and fails his exam. So he had to stay home and fight saboteurs. But yeah, he stayed homeside. He stayed homeside during the war.
One of my favorite little details is the aesthetics. Superman's costume and look has changed so much over the years.
Oh, sure. Well, it started off as they were inspired by very popular figures of the time, circus acrobats and trapeze artists. And so that's where the tights come from, because you needed something that would allow for freedom of movement, but you also needed something that the people in the back rows could really see. So you wanted to outline the form, but you also wanted it to pop, so you had these very garishly colored outfits. The cape was there to really convey speed, because remember, he started off as a creature on the page. And the only way you can really convey how fast somebody is moving, especially back then before they had the iconography we now have today in comics of speed lines, you draw little lines after somebody to kind of signify that. That was before that time, so they needed a cape to flutter and flap. You could actually almost hear it snapping in the breeze in those first few images that we know of Superman. Certainly the Superman S, which is now a very recognized symbol throughout the world, took a long time to evolve. And if you look at it over the course of 75 years, you see that it's still evolving. There's still tweaks that we make to reflect the style of the time. So it's constantly in some kind of state of change. What they've done now is they've taken away the tights and they replaced it with a kind of a weird armor. They've taken away the red pants. Mm-hmm. The red pants will return. But they took away the red pants, but they kept a big old chunky belt. A belt that's not holding anything up. So everything about this character, the spit curl, the pants, the belt, the boots, constantly cycles in and out of fashion. And it always will.
Is the message coming from the comic books one that reflects what we're thinking, or is it coming from the creators trying to send a message to society?
Well, there's the character of Superman, and there's the idea of Superman. The character is constantly iterated and reiterated because he doesn't have what makes a story a story. He doesn't have an ending. He's part of an open-ended narrative in the comics, which means he just keeps churning over. They keep rebooting and killing him off and bringing him back and taking away his red pants and giving his red pants back. But there's the idea of Superman, which is bigger than that. So the character is owned by DC and Warner's. The idea of Superman, which is more powerful, purer than that, which transcends the media that deliver him to us, is owned by the world. And that's why we constantly look to him and look to have him inspire us.
Glen Weldon, the author of Superman, the Unauthorized Biography. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to continue this discussion online. Also there, you can find a slideshow of Superman through the ages and a look at the science of superheroes, from Spider-Man's silk to the Flash's speed. And we want you to weigh in. Who is your favorite comic book character? That's all at newshour.pbs.org.